السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربي يسر ولا تؤسر وتممه لنا بالخير يا فتاه يا فتاه يا فتاح. Brothers and sisters, we are grateful, we are thankful for the bounties and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us in His rahmah and His mercy in this world. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us underneath His shade and His throne on the day when there will be no shade except for the shade of the arsh and the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as we know, brothers and sisters, we're continuing our series known as the Anecdotes of the Noble, where we share with you the counsels and the reflection from the pious. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make these words a means of inspiration for us to change our lives and become better individuals and stronger believers. Inshallah, we do this Monday to Thursday. And as we all know, tomorrow night, inshallah, at 9 p.m. at the same time, Eastern time, we will have our open Q&A session. If you do have any questions in your mind, please keep them with you. And inshallah, we will be able to discuss some of our questions, whichever one that we can answer in detail, and hopefully as a community grow together, and of course, enhance ourselves in Islamic knowledge, understanding, and the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With that being said, let's get to tonight's counsel. Tonight's counsel that I share with you, or the advice that I share with you, is known is reported by a man known as Dhun-Nurayn. For many of us, which already know the meaning of Dhun-Nurayn, which refers to the person who is the possessor of two lights, Nurayn. The word Nur is a single light. Nurayn refers to two lights. And this title was given to the son-in-law of Rasulullah SAW, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. And Uthman radiallahu anhu was married to two daughters of the Prophet SAW. One, when of course Umm Kulthum radiallahu anha, when she passed away, Ruqayya radiallahu anha, and I have mentioned this previously as well, the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Uthman, if I had 10 daughters, which were available as people, a person to be married, one after the other, I would have given you, O Uthman. Meaning, this was the nobility of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to his Sahaba that every Nabi, every Prophet has a Rafiq. Rafiq means a close person, a close individual in relationship. And O Uthman, you are my Rafiq in Jannah. This is what Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave him the glad tidings. On the day of Tabuk, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was planning to go towards the Byzantine Empire, which is a very beautiful story itself, the whole story of Tabuk, where we famously know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu brought everything in his possession to an extent that he brought his own clothing and he wore the rag. And Uthman radiallahu anhu brought half of his possession. And Uthman radiallahu anhu took care and responsibility of one third of the caravan. And he kept on bringing in, kept on bringing the dirhams and dinanir, the gold and silver coins. It is mentioned in the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ was sitting in the courtyard of his masjid, the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ in Medina. May Allah allow us to visit Medina and Mecca again and again with afia. The Prophet ﷺ was sitting in the courtyard. Umar radiallahu anhu came and he placed these coins in the lap of the Prophet ﷺ while he's seated. And the Prophet ﷺ takes his hand and he digs it inside the coins and he lifts them and he drops them. So it makes these noise of the coins, and he keeps on doing this, and he's moving the coins up and down, and he's looking at Uthman, and he said, O Uthman, I am pleased with you, may Allah be pleased with you. O Uthman, do whatever you want, indeed Allah has forgiven you. Meaning, this is the level of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and of course we can talk about these great personalities forever. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu reports, and he mentions, and he says, I have found the sweetness of ibadah, the sweetness of worship in four things. Allahu Akbar. And again, this will be four things combined together as one counsel to take back. And brothers and sisters, I just want to stop here for a second before I get to the details of this. May Allah give us the sweetness of our ibadah. Brothers and sisters, sometimes, you know, it makes me cry and wonder that today, even in my sajda, I don't think of Allah. Today, even in my sajda, there is the ghayr of Allah. There is something other than my Lord and Almighty, the deity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Even in my prostration, the closest that I'm supposed to be in my worship, subhanAllah, I'm unable to find that. Even in the house of Allah, I'm sitting and I'm unable to connect my hearts, you know, and sometimes, you know, it feels like, you know, heart is crying to feel, when will we taste the sweetness of our prayer? That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ju'ilat qurrata a'ini fi salah." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, has placed the coolness of my eyes in the prayer, right? Where do I find contentment? If I'm stressed out, you know, big day, tough day, where do I find contentment? Where do I find sakoon? Where do I find peace in my life, brothers and sisters? What do I resort to when I need some sort of peace, you know? The Prophet, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord Almighty, has placed the contentment of the heart, meaning my eyes and coolness, in prayer. Let's get to the reflection or the counsel which has been attributed to Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. He says, Uthman radiallahu anhu says, I found the sweetness of ibadah, worship, in four things. There are four things that gave me halawa, the sweetness, the taste of ibadah. May Allah give us the sweetness and the taste of our ibadah. May Allah allow us to do the dhikr where our hearts can feel the taste of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He give us the recitation of the Qur'an where our hearts and our minds can reflect over the beauty of the kalam of Allah. So Usman radiallahu anhu said, four things gave me the sweetness of worship. Number one, he says, the first in fulfilling Allah's commandment. The first thing that gave me the sweetness of worship is when I made myself obedient to the commandments of Allah. Whatever I could do, I brought myself on the commandments of Allah. If this was the command of Allah, I made sure that I fulfilled this. Prayer, charity, fasting, rights and responsibility of spouses, neighbors, friends, acquaintances, anyone, meaning anything that is the commandment of the Almighty, he said, as soon as I became fulfilling the commandments of Allah, I began to feel the sweetness of faith. Number one thing, he says, the first thing that I did is that the first in fulfilling Allah's commandment. When I brought myself in the commandments of Allah, I brought myself closer towards feeling the taste and the sweetness of ibadah. Number two, he said, Uthman radiallahu anhu said, and of course, again, with that credential, the Zunnurain, the possessor of two light, he says, the second in abstaining from Allah's prohibitions. The second thing that gave me the nur or the halawa or the taste of ibadah and worship, he said, was abstaining and staying away from the prohibition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever the Almighty told me do not do, I completely stayed away. And when I stayed away from His disobedience, the Almighty, I began to feel the taste of my ibadah. I began to feel the taste of my worship, right? It began to feel as my ibadah, my worship, my tasbih, my Quran was giving me that taste. I felt it, right? Imagine you eat something. And yes, it's fulfilling your belly, but you don't feel that taste, right? Or you're drinking something and it's okay, quenching your thirst, but it may not give you that taste. Imagine, brothers and sisters, making salah and it gives you the sweetness, the sweetness of iman and faith. Imagine recitation of the Quran and gives you the sweetness. Imagine doing tasbih and saying Allah, 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 and giving you the sweetness of your heart. Imagine the feeling. So he said, the first thing that allowed me to receive the sweetness was bringing myself on the commandments of Allah, number one. Number two, abstaining from the prohibitions and the disobedience of Allah. I avoided it, stayed away from it. That's number two. Number three, he said, Uthman radiallahu anhu, he said, the third, in enjoining good, meaning I invited the people towards good but with the intention of attaining the reward from Allah. I never invited anyone towards goodness for the sense that I could be a better individual. My intention of inviting towards good, meaning that was his thing, that I always invited towards good. My thing was that I always wanted someone else to do good. Sheikh Ashraf Ali Thanwi rahimahullah ta'ala anhu, the great scholar of his time, used to say, whenever I wanted something to start in my life, whenever I wanted to inculcate something in my life, I would start preaching about it. I would start telling the people about the fadail and the goodness of it. And it motivated me to do actually that. So Uthman radiallahu anhu said, the third thing that gave me the strength and the sweetness of ibadah and worship is enjoining towards good. I love inviting towards good. I love inviting the people towards good, but not with the intention saying that, you know what, I'm the guy who invites, I'm the chaperone over the people. No, my intention towards inviting towards good was only that I can attain the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only that my Allah can be pleased. Never to put anyone down, never to feel that I'm greater than anyone else and that's why I'm schooling you or I'm telling you, no, but only to attain the reward of Allah. I kept on inviting towards good, kept on inviting towards good. And last but not least, Uthman radiallahu anhu said, the fourth thing that allowed me to develop the sweetness of ibadah and worship is that forbidding evil, but not just forbidding evil, but also fearing the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, I wanted to stop the people from doing wrong. I invited the people towards good, but I also stopped the people from doing wrong. Not because, forgive me for saying, but I'm a haram police that I just give fatwa of haram or you're doing haram and you're, na'udhubillah, going to hellfire and you're, no. I invited the people towards goodness for seeking the reward of Allah alone. And I help the people stop from evil for the reasons of being aware of the wrath of Allah. Meaning, I'm no one to judge anyone, but at least I can hold the hand of my brother and sister in not doing the wrong. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh my Sahaba, help the oppressed and help the one who oppresses and the one who's oppressed. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how can we help the zalim? We understand help the mazloom, the oppressed. We understand. The person is mazloom, the person is oppressed. We can help him. Yes, we understand. Ya Rasulullah, how can we help the zalim, the oppressor? The Prophet ﷺ said, by holding his hand and bringing him towards goodness. Stopping him from that oppression is good for that individual. Help him and support him in doing what is correct. So whenever we invite towards goodness, brothers and sisters, it has to be very important that we synchronize our niyyah, our intention solely for the sake of Allah. Be sincere in rectifying the wrongs of others. Never expose the people if their mistakes are individual. If a mistake of a person is collectively harming the society, yes, you make it as a public thing. But if it's an individual assessment of action of an individual, then as sincerely as we can, we invite the people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll mention a very quick story before I finish. I hope I can get through this time. One day, Uthman Umar radiallahu anhu was patrolling the streets of Medina. And Uthman Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was the Khalifa, the successor, he took this as a responsibility. He would walk and patrol the streets of Medina. One day while he was patrolling the streets of Medina, he heard something fishy from one house where he felt that something was not right. Allah had given him foresight, firasat. Allah had bestowed upon him. This was the treasure of a believer that Allah grants them firasat, foresight, wisdom. And Uthman Umar radiallahu anhu had that. So he felt something fishy from one house. Umar radiallahu anhu told his person, his secretary, or the person who was with him, his name was Aslam. He was outside. And some said it was Abdullah radiallahu anhu. So he said, stay outside. Umar radiallahu anhu jumped the wall. He went inside the house. He found an old man sitting down in his house and he was drinking alcohol in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu saw this man and said, you are old man in your end life. You're involved in haram and wrong and disobedience. This man looked at Uthman radiallahu anhu and said, he looked at Umar and said, Umar, I know I'm a sinner. I know this is a mistake, but this is one sin between me and my Allah. But you made three sins. You entered my house without my permission. Secondly, you were spying upon me. And number three, you did not enter the house from the door as you were supposed to, which the Quran says, enter from the places where you're supposed to in the houses. I made one mistake. You made three mistakes. Three commandments of Allah you broke. Usman radiallahu anhu cried so profusely after hearing this old man's word that he stuck a piece of cloth in his mouth so his crying cannot be heard by the man standing outside. And he rushed to his house. Many days passed that this man never showed up to the majlis of Uthman Umar radiallahu anhu. He never came to the masjid because he was too afraid. Many days passed, this old man came, very scared. He was sitting in the back of the masjid. Umar radiallahu anhu saw this old man. He said, come close. And this guy is scared. This old man is scared that, you know what, I'm getting exposed. I'm going to get beat. I'm going to get whatever. Subhanallah. He comes close. Umar radiallahu anhu said, come closer. Come more closer. This man came so close that it was as though that the lips of Umar radiallahu anhu almost touched his ears that no one could hear. And he said, Oh my brother, the day that I left your house and I saw you drinking, I swear by Allah, I never told anyone that I saw you drinking. Meaning I never told anyone about your mistake. This old man said, Oh Umar, since the day that you left my house, I never touched alcohol again in my life as well. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, there's so many things to take back from this story. But this is how sincere correction is. This is how we really invite towards good and stop from evil. Making sure that our intentions are sincere when we want goodness in the lives of others. Today, we want to change others. Why? Because may Allah forgive, we want to put them down. So people can know that so-and-so is evil. Brothers and sisters, let's rectify our intentions. I'm sorry, I'm 2 minutes ahead of my time. But let's continue, go back from this advice. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, the possessor of two lights and nur, says, I found sweetness, halawa, taste of ibadah and worship in four things. Number one, first in fulfilling the commandments of Allah. Number two, second in abstaining from Allah's prohibition. Whatever Allah does not want me to do, I stay away from it. Number three is enjoining good with the intention of only attaining Allah's pleasure, nothing from people. And number four is forbidding evil and fearing Allah's wrath and forbidding the evil in the lives of others. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us these beautiful qualities. May He give us the halawat and the taste of iman. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to live our life according to the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, just a quick announcement, inshallah, tomorrow is the day of Jum'ah. Please keep yourself busy as much as you can with durood and salawat upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If Allah gives you the strength, recite Surah Al-Kahf from the beginning till the end. If you cannot, then at least the beginning 10 ayats, the last 10 ayats of Surah Al-Kahf we should recite. Engage yourself in dua and supplication. The Prophet ﷺ said, there is a moment, there is a time on the day of Jummah that whatever my slave and servant, man or woman, asks for, I will grant them. So Jummah is also a day of ibadah and worship itself. Also, Islamic Center of Long Island is restarting the larger gathering of prayers, inshallah, not in full capacity, but inshallah, being able to accommodate 200 congregants, brothers and sisters, in one salah, 1 p.m., 2 p.m. and 2:45, inshallah. I will be giving the Jummah bayan in all the three prayers, inshallah. I will be leading the first, but inshallah, giving the bayan for all the three prayers. So you can divide and distribute yourself for one, two, and third salah, inshallah, which is at 2:45. Please go and check on our website for all the requirements, making sure you have a mask, you have a prayer mat. Please bring your own bag where you can keep your shoes, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq and ability to do what is correct and right in our life. Please keep me and the entire ummah in your dua. Inshallah, we'll see you tomorrow. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.